Boa noite a todos, mais um fórum, muito bom estar aqui com vocês e é um prazer poder estar entrevistando o Oliver Shanarin, que é um expoente muito importante da fotografia contemporânea. Então, o que nós vamos fazer é o seguinte: eu vou fazer uma pequena apresentação sobre ele, ele vai mostrar um vídeo e depois a gente segue para as perguntas. Eu vou fazer uma citação aqui que eu acho interessante, que eu li dentro de uma série de entrevistas que ele fez. É uma citação que aparece de vez em quando junto ao trabalho deles. É uma citação do Edward Steichen, que fala que o papel da fotografia é explicar o homem para o homem e cada homem a si mesmo. Bom, Oliver Shanarin nasceu em 1971 em Londres e o seu sócio, Adam Bloomberg, nasceu em 70 em Johannesburg, na África do Sul. Se conheceram trabalhando no Colors Magazine e há mais de 2 décadas investigam as complexas relações entre imagem e poder. O seu corpo de trabalho aborda questões desde o fotojornalismo a projetos curatoriais, assim como a discussão sobre sistemas de trauma, vigilância, autoridade e o grau que a própria representação está implicada nesses discursos. Sua obra é identificada com questões de como o colonialismo e a história da fotografia se confundem e como a fotografia tem uma atuação num sistema de poder. Entendem que a linguagem da fotografia tem que ser aprendida num sistema de decodificação e investigam o poder de revelar o acaso e o esquecimento se inserindo nesse sistema de poder. Inicialmente, tinha uma abordagem de fotojornalismo mais direto, que evidenciava o poder e o papel da representação e da pessoa efetuando o trabalho. Em trabalhos mais recentes, a imagem fica em segundo plano, diante da realidade por trás da câmera, no sentido de. No interesse deles no próprio processo do trabalho. A tecnologia é vista como algo que tem uma ideologia por trás e subentende-se que não há neutralidade da imagem. Outra característica de ambos é a importância que o trabalho de arquivos tem em sua obra e como o poder se faz através dos arquivos. Suas instalações vão além de expor esquemas de poder e loucura e expõem um universo em paralelo de arbitrariedades, guerras, prisões e outros eventos que estão fora do nosso olhar cotidiano. Let's show you a film. Vou mostrar o filme agora e depois a gente passa para as perguntas.
And there is a lot of discrepancies in that. Let's go from the third bar, please.
Keep it tight. Left, right, left, right, left, right, left. Go on. Halt. Left, right, left, right, left, right, left. Far left. Left. Right.
Something about a soldier. Does that nursery rhyme-ish, yeah. So that's that. If you listen to them, they will set your pitch where you've got to start singing. Okay, let's just have that cornet-wise. Let's have, just have.
Thank you. When I used to be afraid of the words, but with you I learned just to let it out. Now my heart is ready to burst, 'cause I feel like I'm ready for love. And I wanna be everything and more. And I know every day I say it, but I just want you to be sure that I am yours.
Oliver, eu queria conversar com você um pouco sobre esse seu sentido de humor. O que é o humor dentro do seu trabalho, esse elemento anárquico que é introduzido dentro de um filme que você está vendo uma ordem militar, você está vendo uma estrutura oficial, e você traz a figura do bufuno para desmontar esse sistema. Você pode falar sobre isso?
Yeah, this works. Hi, everybody. First of all, it's a real honor to be here. So thank you to the whole team for bringing me. And sadly, Adam, my partner, wasn't able to come for very last-minute emergency medical reasons. So he's very sad not to be here. I really enjoyed watching that film again because I haven't seen it for a while. And it does make me laugh. And I think that you ask about humor. I think we set out to make a work that really made us laugh. And I think we wanted to give ourselves permission to do that, because very often we take ourselves too seriously. I'm talking about me and Adam, not you guys or the world. But we take ourselves a little seriously. And humor can be very powerful as a way of addressing a subject. And in this case, the subject is youth, in a way. The subject is about being a child. And this transition into adulthood, you know, and going from being somebody who is, you know, about to become an adult and is about to sort of, what happens when we become an adult? We start to accept the rules of society around us, and we start to understand them, and we internalize them. And you can see that in those kids that are trying to learn how to march, but they're chaotic, and they don't know how to march. And they're going around, and the woman is screaming at them and screaming at them. And you don't really see it in the film, because we did actually get kicked out of the camp quite early on. But they do end up becoming quite good at marching and playing their instruments and things. So, you know, we were interested in this transition into adulthood and this acceptance of the laws of society. And we wanted to insert into this thing the inverse. We wanted to stick into the middle of this place the inverse of being a soldier, the inverse of being a responsible adult. And the buffon character, this ridiculous, grotesque figure, was a perfect solution, really. She presented herself to us. And we thought, this is the person we have to take with us, because she can really be subversive in the context of this camp.
Essa figura é como um pouco o personagem que existia nas cortes medievais, a figura do palhaço, do jester, que na realidade era quem dizia a verdade na corte. Então, essa figura desse bufuno parece um pouco, dentro daquela ordem, daquele caos, o fato dela ser essa pessoa ridícula, anárquica, ela traz à tona o ridículo da situação como um todo. Agora, tem uma outra questão que faz parte desse trabalho, que é uma questão de expectativas. Quando você vai fazer um trabalho desse tipo, você certamente se dirige, digamos, no caso, às autoridades que permitiram você filmar isso, dizendo que você vai desenvolver um certo tipo de trabalho. Ao longo do trabalho, você tem uma estratégia de mudança e você introduz esse elemento do anárquico. Como que isso é recebido? O que acontece no processo do trabalho?
It's not received very well. We were talking today in the workshop with my students about institutions, because institutions are not very different to people. They're quite vain and they like attention. And when you send them a letter and you say, I'd like to come and showcase what you do, that's very appealing. And I think for all the photographers who are sitting in the audience today will know that so much of being a photographer is about an act of seduction and about, in a very mundane way, about getting into places, about access, about being convincing. And so, yes, we approached the cadet camp and we were genuinely interested in what they were doing. You know, and we didn't go in there with the idea of the bouffant, and we didn't go in with the idea of mocking them, actually. And I think what's very important to us is that the bouffant isn't mocking the children, but she's mocking the institution, the army. And that's the difficult line to get right. And I'm not sure we do get it right, because I know that some people find that film quite offensive. Sorry.
Os cadetes chegaram a ver o filme? The kids, did they see the film?
We haven't sent them a copy. But it's out there in the world. We just explain a little bit about the way the film was made. The bouffant came, and she's a professional bouffant. That's her job. And she, you're absolutely right, the bouffant is a medieval character who was invited into the court of the king, the royal court. And the job of the bouffant was a little bit different to the jester, because the jester was just about kind of making everything funny. The bouffant is actually allowed to mock the king and is invited to mock power. And that's his job. If he goes too far, he gets his head chopped off. But if he gets the balance right, he'll be okay. So we brought her to the camp and we said, we want you to teach the children how to not be soldiers. So every day they were learning to march, they would come to our workshop and we would teach them how to fall over. Falling over is what soldiers never do, unless they're dead. Soldiers never close their eyes because soldiers are always vigilant. So we asked them to close their eyes for a long time, for a length of time that was so uncomfortable that the authorities came in and told us to stop. Stop making them close their eyes, they said. We taught them some slapstick comedies, such as, you know, slapping them. And I'd like to talk a little bit about slapstick, because slapstick is premised on the idea of people hurting themselves, but we're allowed to laugh. In slapstick, people fall over, but because it's happening in a comic frame, we're given permission to laugh. So it was interesting to us because it's a very rare example where you're allowed to laugh at somebody else's pain. So much so that it feels it's like a caricature. And a lot of our work has been in the past about the way photography is drawn to sites of violence and the way that photographers are drawn to these, and photography as a subject is drawn to sites of violence and is interested in depicting human suffering. And it was interesting to us the possibility of depicting pain, human pain, but for it to be funny, and how we make that transition. I don't know if that made any sense.
Bom, a gente tem muito assunto, então, continuando. É uma pergunta simples e difícil, né? O que é verdade na fotografia? Bertolt Brecht disse que a fotografia em nada ajuda a esclarecer fatos do mundo e modificá-los. Como vocês entendem o papel do fotojornalismo e como trabalham seus arquivos? E se a revisão e o levantamento desses arquivos atuam no sentido de trazer alguma mudança? Nós conversamos um pouquinho antes e nós pensamos em mostrar People in Trouble. Você poderia falar um pouco sobre People in Trouble?
Yeah. Thank you. That's, I mean, it's a very interesting pressing question, and you brought up Bertolt Brecht, who's obviously, many of you will know, was a German playwright, who was very interested in photography, even though he was really a playwright and a novelist. And one of the things I always take from Brecht is the way he referred to his work, because he didn't call it work, he called it attempts. The word attempts is more interesting than the idea of a piece of work, because it suggests that something's not finished. Yeah, it's ongoing, so we might revisit it at some point. And I think we think about our works a bit like that. They're an attempt at something. They may be a failure, they may be a success. Well, they're normally not a success. They're normally a failure. Brecht was very interested in photographs, and he was interested in the kind of photographs that appeared in newspapers. And it's important to remember that during the Second World War, photojournalism was still quite a new thing, and seeing photographs in newspapers was still quite new. And there were certain kinds of images at that time that were extremely new, such as aerial photography. Nobody had seen the world from above. Nobody had looked down. And it was a shocking way to see the planet, and especially when it was taken from a plane that was dropping bombs. So he was very interested in the depiction of war and the idea of the technology of image making around conflict. And he talked about photographs as being very complicated and almost a bit like a hieroglyphics, like an Egyptian hieroglyphics, like something that needed to be decoded, to be demystified. And I really agree with him, and I think that a lot of our work is about trying to demystify, but also trying to complicate the meanings of photographs. And let's talk about People in Trouble, because you mentioned it. And I think it's helpful in terms of the topic of photojournalism, because this is an archive. You can see on the screen a contact strip from an archive in Northern Ireland called Belfast Exposed. And this is one of hundreds of thousands of contact strips that are held in a very small room in Belfast. And it's an archive that was created by photojournalists that were living in Belfast during the Troubles. The Troubles were around like from the 70s to the late 80s and or mid 80s. And these photojournalists were living in a war zone. They were documenting their lives and this war that was unfolding around them. But at the same time, they were teaching photography to young people, to students, to teenagers. And the material that they produced during these workshops got mixed up with all of the photojournalistic images that they were taking. This was a collective of many photographers. And when we were invited to come and look at it and respond to it in some way. And we looked at these pictures, and what struck us is how diverse the imagery was. And sometimes you would see on the same strip of film, you would see a very classic photojournalistic image from the war, you know, the Troubles in Northern Ireland. So it might be an IRA funeral or a running battle with the British Army. And on the other end of the same piece of film, you might have children pulling their pants down, you know, and showing their bum to the camera, or, you know, people photographing their girlfriends naked, or grandparents drinking tea, and really ordinary stuff. And, you know, I think war is like that. War is full of a lot of drama, and it's full of a lot of boredom as well, and a lot of normal stuff. And that's what we liked about it. But what this, you've got to remember, this is a contested archive that is being pulled and pushed in lots of ways. You know, lots of people wanted access to these pictures. You had activists, you had journalists, you had lawyers, you had the people in the pictures. And what we noticed was that when you looked at these pictures, that the traces of all the people that had visited it were left on the pictures. So like this, you see, I've taken the picture away and I've just left the dots. These dots, I don't know if you have these in Brazil, but you do. They're little sticky things, you put them on, it's to select the picture. None of these things have been placed there in any particular order with any particular intent. But somehow, as a result of putting the sticker there, a part of the image has been obscured. right? So what Adam and I decided to do, and I'm getting to your question about truth, what we decided to do is to look underneath the sticker to see what was there. And we made a cardboard mask like this, which is that some people sometimes ask us, why was it that size? And it was that size because it was cut from a CD that we found, you know. And then we began to print the pictures, the areas of the negative that were concealed by the sticker. And you can see here some of the images. And I think, you know, what immediately when we started doing this, the archivists became quite worried because they became quite concerned that they weren't able to identify which pictures were from which box. And they weren't able to identify, you know, is that the head of Sean's daughter when we went to the IRA funeral, or is it another day? We don't remember. So this idea of history, of memory, starts to kind of fall apart with these fragments. And a different sort of story about the Troubles unfolds, not really the one that the archive is trying to tell. You know, so I think the artist, me and Adam, are asked to come and look at the archive and to do something. What do we want? What do we expect the artist or the photographer? What do we want him to do? Must he put it in order? Must he mess it up? Must he cut it up? What is the expectation of the artist? And we ended up with a series of photographs that are not composed by us, but they're composed by the very random gesture of the archivist putting the sticker down. And I think that really appealed to us, the idea that the authorship was somehow blurred, that we were the authors of these works, but there were other authors involved. It was a bit like a kind of a collaboration with history in a way, could be a way of describing it.
What about truth in the sense that que tipo de verdade que traz esse processo de trabalhar o arquivo, ele traz um tipo de verdade, que é uma verdade que não tem a ver com um conceito tradicional, no sentido de que não é uma reprodução da realidade, é uma verdade que tem a ver com uma investigação que vocês fazem. Então, pensando nesse sentido, eu fico imaginando esses negativos, esses arquivos, são arquivos tradicionais no sentido de negativos. Como será o trabalho do futuro arquivo digital? Quer dizer, vocês daqui a, sei lá, olhando toda as imagens digitais do mundo de hoje, que não tem mais esse tipo de arquivamento, como é que vocês veem isso?
That's a really good question, and I feel kind of overwhelmed with the scale of the archive that's being generated all the time by the internet and by surveillance cameras, and you know, what is it going to mean to us in the future? I don't know. But you know, our job is to try to unpick the meaning of these things, and not always to explain them, but to complicate it a bit. You know, and I think this idea of these dots, it's just a little game. It's not a serious thing, but it's just asking us to kind of revisit what we think is our memory and our history of this event, and recognize that there's lots of ways into it. There's lots of different ways to interpret the material, and that any photograph can be interpreted in many, many myriad different ways, depending on the context that it's in. You know, the context is very important. If it's in a newspaper, it has one context. A picture in a newspaper is telling us the truth. If it's in an art gallery, it doesn't have the burden of having to do that. It has another job to do. So, you know, I think we, Adam and I, play a lot with where we place things and the context. But I'd like to talk more about this digital archive question. Okay. But we should come back to it. Should we talk about...
Violence now?
Well, okay. We'll come back to it then. Okay.
Bom, Divine Violence foi feito em 2015. Esse projeto teve como ponto de partida a premissa dada por Adir Ofir sobre Deus, e eles utilizaram imagens do Archive of Modern Conflict no formato da Bíblia para trabalhar nesse projeto. Os textos foram utilizados para guiar uma seleção de imagens norteadas pelo conceito de Adir. O conceito do Adir é que, desde o começo, em todas as suas aparições, Deus traz a catástrofe. A catástrofe é o seu meio de operação e o seu sistema central de governança. Deus se revela predominantemente, portanto, pela catástrofe, e os sistemas de poder na Bíblia estão correlacionados com os sistemas de poder modernos de governança. Então, ele faz uma analogia a essa visão da autoridade vindo sempre sob a forma de catástrofe. Dentro da Bíblia, se utilizam da estrutura da Bíblia e juntam a Bíblia as imagens desse Modern Archive of Conflict. Queria que ele falasse um pouquinho sobre esse trabalho.
Well done for managing to say that, because it's complicated, and I think you brought up some really interesting points. We talked about Brecht earlier, and we were working in Berlin at the Brecht Archive on a previous project, War Primer 2, when one of the curators at the archive offered to show us Brecht's Bible. He had had a Bible that he had used as a notebook when he was in exile, and he wasn't reading the Bible, he was using it as paper, because he was in exile in Finland, in Sweden, then Finland, and later he was in San Francisco, in Los Angeles. This object really struck us as incredible, because he had stuck on the cover of it a picture of a racing car that he had cut out of Life magazine. And when we opened the picture, when we opened the book, you can see he'd stuck in a newspaper clipping into the Bible, and he'd used the Bible as this kind of notebook, and it inspired us to try to make an illustrated Bible. And there's a long history of illustrated Bibles that go back for centuries, so this is very much part of that tradition. I think what's different about this one is the use of archival imagery and the relationship between the images and the text, because the images sit very much on the text and they obscure parts of the text, and we use parts of the text as a kind of caption for the images. The book looks like a Bible, so it's kind of a trick. You open it and you get a shock. Hold on, something's wrong. It's a bit of a juvenile gesture. Oh, well, let's take the Bible and stick pictures in it. But I think there was something else going on in our minds, and it was, you mentioned Adi Ophir, who's an Israeli philosopher, and we were reading his book, Divine Violence, which talks about the Bible as a kind of parable for the emergence of government. So he describes how in the Old Testament, at the beginning, terrible things happen. You know, terrible, terrible things happen to people, and people get killed, and nobody knows why. And then you have the Ten Commandments, and suddenly there's law,
right?
There are these laws, and these laws are linked to punishment. And so you have this relationship between law and punishment, catastrophe. And for us, you know, thinking about the story of photography has always been interested in catastrophe, and as I mentioned earlier. And so we thought, the other thing about the history of photography is it has a kind of biblical scale to it. Since it was invented, photography has wanted to sort of document everything about the world that we live in. Photography wants to be there when we're born. It wants to be there when we die. It wants to see us having sex. It wants to see us falling in love. It wants to, you know, photography wants to capture everything. It's biblical in scale. And so we had this idea that it would be interesting to use the history of photography to illustrate the Bible. And our first attempt was, we were in conversation with a collector, an American collector in England called Michael Wilson, who wanted us to do something. And we proposed to use the Bible to use his collection to illustrate the Bible, and he said no. I think that I think his wife didn't like the idea, but in the end, we went to another archive in London called the Archive of Modern Conflict, and that is a really extraordinary place. It's a private collection of images of war that go from the Crimean War to the present day. It's funded by members of the Reuters family, but it's got nothing to do with Reuters. It's very much its own thing, and it's quite strange and quite idiosyncratic, and I think the word I would use is it's a kind of unofficial history of photography. So, for example, one of the things that they have there is a large collection of soldiers' albums by Nazi soldiers. And you see in these albums, you see young men hugging their wives, saying goodbye to their children, playing football with their friends behind the enemy lines. You see people, you know, you don't see monsters. And those kind of images are quite difficult to get hold of and to see. And people, they don't fit into the narrative of the Holocaust. So you would never see photographs like that in an Israeli archive. So, you know, this was very interesting to us. And we thought, how can we create relationships between these pictures and the words on the pages of the Bible? I don't know if you can read any of that, but you can see on the bottom right there, we've underlined a part of the text. So there it reads, "And he will be a wild man, and his hand will be against every man, and every man against him." So that line, and we thought, well, that's interesting to put that line with this picture of this baby being born. But it's not a kind of typical picture, it's a model. So we're trying to create relationships between the text, the parts that we underline, and the photographs. And sometimes the text explains what you're looking at. Sometimes it contradicts what you're looking at. Sometimes it just sort of relates these two pictures together. So there isn't a rule, really. But one thing we noticed that, and anyone who's studied the Bible will know that there's one phrase that comes up again and again and again throughout the text. And it's in English, it's... And it came to pass. And it came to pass. And sometimes it's, "and so it came to pass." And then other times it's, "and it will come to pass." And this phrase, which comes up again and again, felt to us a bit like, you know, in like a telenovela where it says, "tune in next week for the next episode." You know, there was something about this line that tickled. I don't know if you know this word, tickled. It like tickled us. And we decided that whenever that line came, we would put a photograph from the collection that showed something magical happening. Something magical. So here we have, you know, somebody juggling. On the previous page here, here's a woman levitating, right? There was one box that we found in the archive full of magic tricks. And the reason we wanted to have this little magic trick there is that this is a text full of catastrophe. It's full of violence. Anyone who's read the Bible will know it's violent. But one person's catastrophe is another person's miracle. You know, look at what happened in Orlando last week. Some people died, and it was a catastrophe. For somebody else, it was their miracle. They survived. And so it's two sides of the same coin, basically. And that's why there's these magic tricks in there.
Eu estou pensando aqui, tem um outro aspecto desse trabalho que permeia, na realidade, todos os seus trabalhos, que é a relação do texto com a imagem e a necessidade de recontextualizar a imagem. Então, você traz um sentido novo para a imagem e para o texto. E, em alguns momentos, vocês comentam que vocês... A dificuldade em que isso se dá no sentido de que você explica demais o trabalho, ou você fica, o trabalho fica retórico ou não retórico. E essa questão da apropriação da imagem no formato do livro é uma constante também no trabalho de vocês. O livro é um formato principal para a obra de vocês?
We like to make books, and we've made quite a few. But I always think that the form of the work is really comes out of the work. So, you know, there are some projects of ours that don't make sense to be a book, you know, and others that do. And you know, Divine Violence is actually a book, and the Holy Bible Project is a book and an exhibition. And the reason for that is, when we made this work, the way we made it was, in our studio, we put all the pages of the Bible on the wall, and then we cut out the pictures and we started to put them on the wall like this. And it was an act of collage, and actually we never saw this thing as a book. It was always like this big wall of images. And when you look at a wall of images and you take in all of them at the same time, it's a very different experience to holding a book, which is a much more personal experience, where you can close a book, you know? You can go, ah, I can't look at that anymore, and you close it, right? You can look at things one-on-one. There's a very personal relationship. With a wall of images, it's very different, and it's kind of overwhelming. And so in that case, we made the book, but then we realized that actually the original form was also interesting. And so we made a series of works where we framed each chapter of the Bible. There are 57, I think, in that case. So books are bad for the environment. That's the one thing about them I don't like. They're also very heavy, which is not good. But they're cheap. And in a world, in an art world where the price of art has escalated and become unaffordable for most people, the book is still something within reach, and that's what's so beautiful about it. And that's why I think it endures as a form, partly.
Bom, indo aqui para outros temas, a fotografia no fotojornalismo é uma forma de investigação que se impõe naturalmente. Vocês, entretanto, discutem isso, como isso se passa e como ocorre a relação entre o fotografado e o fotógrafo dentro de um sistema de poder. Quais são os mecanismos envolvidos? Aí eu pensei na gente conversar um pouco sobre trust, ghetto e o they nobody died.
Okay. Well, this is the first picture that Adam and I ever took together. And maybe now's a good time just to say that Adam and I have been working together 20 years. And we're very old friends, and we started working together editing Colors magazine, which is the Benetton magazine. And we borrowed my father's camera to take this picture, and we got permission to go into a hospital in London and photograph this woman who is under anesthetic. And we actually made a series of portraits like this of many people asleep. In English, the expression is going under. You know, you go to the hospital and they put you under, and then they operate on you, and then they wake you up again, right? It's kind of a small death, a temporary death in a way. And what we were interested, I mean, you know, we spent a lot of time trying to get permission to do this. We asked the hospital, we got access to the hospital. Then once we were inside, we asked the patients, each one by one, can we take a picture of you when you're going under? And, you know, we went through all the correct stages, but still these pictures felt transgressive to us. You know, they felt like you were stepping slightly too far. There was something about the privacy of the person that felt invasive in an interesting way. You know, one of the things that really surprised us was that everybody that we asked said yes. Everybody, not one person said no. And then we understood that you know, we had been asked to wear the doctor's uniform, the hospital uniform, and so they thought we were doctors, and that's why they said yes. And they had aligned us with the institution. And you know, when you're sick and you're feeling vulnerable and you're in a hospital, you don't argue with the doctor. You just say yes, sir, no, sir, whatever. You know, you kind of give over responsibility to this higher force. The higher force is the institution. So we were seen as being part of the institution. And I think very often the camera is seen as part of the institution. And we were concerned about privacy. We were concerned about the idea of consent. We were concerned about the idea of the individual in relationship to the institution. And the idea that this person can, you know, say, yes, you can take my picture, but then when it comes to it, they can't compose themselves. And what's really fascinating is that those themes are present in all of our work since then. And it's just a real kind of mystery to me how these themes keep coming up and up again. The same concerns keep coming up.
Em relação a esse mesmo trabalho, num certo momento vocês falam que está embutido no conceito da fotografia uma ideia de uma promessa. Que promessa é essa? Essa promessa faz com que as pessoas sejam mais disponíveis para serem fotografadas? É uma forma de que as pessoas imaginam que vai existir alguma denúncia a partir da fotografia? O que, que é essa promessa?
It's a hidden promise. It's a hidden promise that I think happens every time somebody picks up a camera and takes a picture. And it depends on the context, but I mean, take an example like this one. This is a photograph that we took in Polsmoor Prison in South Africa with a large format camera. And the hidden promise here is these guys thought that by standing and being in our picture that something would happen. That something could happen. That this could help them in some way. And of course this picture never helped them. And between the photographer and the subject there's a flow of power, and sometimes it's a nice one and sometimes it's a poisonous one. But it's normally in the direction of from the camera to the subject and not the other way around. And, we started to feel a bit uncomfortable with this and realized that we couldn't just go around taking pictures, that somehow we wanted to, and this is not for everybody, this is our personal thing. I think it's wonderful that some people feel free to go and take pictures and it's an easy thing. But for us, it just felt really problematic and really difficult. And I don't know if that's because, I don't know why it is. I mean, I think it might be linked to the fact that we're South African, that we're white, that we're Jewish, that there's just there's something in our DNA. I don't know what it is, but there was something about this just blasé act of walking into these places and using the camera as a tool that started to feel uncomfortable.
E isso mudou o que no trabalho de vocês? What changes did it bring?
I think what was clear to us is that these people in this photograph or this lady here or this guy who's a patient in a psychiatric hospital, you know, he doesn't know what we're doing when we take his picture, and he doesn't understand that it's a piece of it's a commodity, that the picture gets taken, but then it gets printed, it gets sold, it gets shown in museums, it gets shown in magazines, it has a value, it accrues value, it gets seen in books about the history of photography, etc. And so, none of that is known to this person who's in the picture. And I think what we, perhaps it gets a bit boring, but we started to think about the mechanisms behind photography. And to answer your question, I'm just going to skip through these things because there's way too much. That's a very depressed cosmonaut, by the way. The reason he's depressed is that he never went to space. Like most Russian cosmonauts, they spend their life in training, but then never go. Mandela. Just speeding through this. This was a project that we did looking at ghettoized communities around the world. And we went to 12 different ghettoized communities. You're always using a large format camera, always placing the subject in front of the camera, asking them to look into the lens, trying to work very closely in a collaborative way with the subject, and using kind of words. You asked about words earlier, using words as a way to sort of make it okay. You know, okay, we're going to find out this person's name, and we're going to ask him some questions, and we're going to make it nice, you know? But it still didn't feel quite right. And, you know, a lot of things happened for us as we started to kind of worry about the photographic process. And I'll show you a little clip of a project we did. You mentioned The Day That Nobody Died. And I think this was a real turning point for me and Adam. We had been asked to be on the jury of the World Press Photo Awards, and it was a very peculiar experience. And one of the things that we noticed doing that, looking at all these photographs, was how sanitized the images of war were that were coming out of Afghanistan and Iraq at the time. And we decided that we wanted to make photographs in a war zone, but we didn't know how we could do it. And we understood that the reason that these pictures were so sanitized, so empty of kind of any signs or traces of conflict or violence, was that all of them had been made by photographers that had been embedded in the war. Now, embedded means that they had signed an agreement that they would go to the war and they would be in the theater of war on the front line, and the army would take them there, the army would feed them and look after them and give them access to the war. But by signing this agreement, they gave access to the journalists as well and to their pictures. And you had to have your pictures checked every day, you know, and the ones that weren't good, we had to delete them. So we got embedded with the British Army, but we decided the only way that we could be subversive in an embedded situation was to refuse to take pictures at all. So we said, okay, we're not going to take any pictures. Instead, we took this box. And in the box is 50 meters of photographic paper, which is obviously very light sensitive. And this is in Afghanistan in the summer of 2008. It was boiling hot. And the paper was literally cooking inside the box. And we, you know, when we arrived, the soldiers picked it up and carried it for us. And you can see that they're sort of unwitting actors in this kind of performance, right? And when something happened that we would ordinarily want to photograph as a journalist, we instead unrolled 6 meters of this paper, exposed it to the light, and then put it back in the box. And we did this by taking over a tank that we could close the door and close the windows, and inside it was completely dark, so we could open the box, take the paper out, and expose it. And eventually, the British Army realized that we were not taking any pictures, and they sent us home. So, you know, it was a bit like the story of the Buffon. You know, when they realized that we were working with the Buffon, they kicked us out. So we got kicked out of the thing, and we went back home, and we processed these pieces of paper. These are pieces of paper that have been to the war and come back. So this is original material. It's scratched. It's cooked. And you can see some of the results. These are details of some of these exposures. On the first day of our trip, a fixer for the BBC was executed by a Taliban ambush. And so we exposed a piece of paper and 6 meters long, and we called it the fixer's execution. So again, the words are very important, because without the words, this wouldn't mean anything. On the third day, I think, the 100th British soldier was killed. And, you know, it was mayhem in the camp, in Camp Bastion, where we ended up. And we made an exposure as he was being taken off the helicopter and taken into the hospital. And we called that the day of the 100th death. This was actually called the repatriation. It was made as an exposure on the day that this 100th British soldier was repatriated to the UK. And here you can see an installation of a couple of them. The one on the right is the day of the 100th death, and the one on the left is called the day nobody died because that was the only day in the 12 days that we were there that nobody officially died. So it's kind of an ironic statement. But these images, I think incorrectly, were seen as a sort of attack on the photojournalistic community, and I don't think they were. I really believe in photography, and I think it's important as a form of evidence. And I don't think this was intended as a kind of criticism of photojournalism as an art form. But I think they're photographs that are not photographs, and they're photographs that don't show anything. And because of that, they sort of reflect back at you, and they ask you a question. You know, they say, what is it that you want to see? What is it that you expect me to bring back?
É um pouco como a estratégia do humor. Da mesma forma que vocês usam a estratégia do humor para acentuar a dramaticidade, nesse caso, a estratégia da não-imagem acentua o drama da situação. Uma pergunta relacionada a isso. Vocês diversas vezes usam a mentira como uma forma de estratégia para chegar a alguma verdade. Em que outras situações, além dessa, essa estratégia foi usada?
What else have we got here? We don't like to lie to people who we like, but we do lie to people that we don't like. So I don't have a problem with lying to the Israeli Defense Force, for example, in order to get access and make a work, because I don't like the Israeli Defense Force. I don't mind lying to the people that shout at little kids, teaching them how to be a soldier, because I don't like what they're doing, particularly, but I like the kids. We have told a few lies, it's true. It is a strategy, and as I said earlier, access is really the key to a lot of our work, and sometimes you have to, there's an act of seduction, and part of that isn't always telling the truth. One example is this. We were invited to Gabon to make a series of photographs of Gabon, and this, photographers, you know that these sort of invitations happen. People go, oh, well, he's a photographer, let's invite him, and he can take pictures of our country. In this case, the person who was inviting us was the wife of the dictator of Gabon. Her name is Michelle Bongo, and she's married to Ali Bongo, who is the son of the longest living dictator of Africa. So, and the invitation was, come and take pictures of our country. Gabon is a very small country in West Africa. It's very rich because it has oil, and it's partly why it's a dictatorship. And so we went, but before we went, we did a lot of research, and we were very interested in the history, the story of color photography, and how, at the end of segregation in America, before color photography, black and white photography, you suddenly had white kids and black kids living in the same class, going to the same school for the first time. And you would have this classic school photograph, of the kids. But black and white film wasn't able to take a picture of black and white kids in the same picture. You could expose for the black or the white, but you couldn't get both. And it showed up a problem in the film. The film was racist. And later, when color film was invented, it was very good at photographing white skin, but it was not very good at photographing black skin. And Polaroid knew about this, but they didn't care, because black people were not their customers. It was only the furniture industry who make wooden things, brown wooden things, and the chocolate industry that make, chocolate bars. They complained. They said, we can't photograph chocolate, we can't photograph wood. You need to invent a color film that works with brown. And they did, and that was a film that it was the beginning of a film that in the end became Kodak Gold, which is the film like we used on holiday when I was a kid, and interestingly, the The Kodak advertising department came up with a slogan to describe this film. They said, this is a film that's good for photographing the details of a dark horse in low light, which meant it was good for photographing people with black skin, essentially. To cut a very long story very short, we bought a lot of this racist film on eBay. This is rolls of film that had never been exposed, but was from the early 50s. And we went to Gabon to photograph Gabon, but we photographed it with this racist film. And we went deep into, they gave us a jeep, and we went deep into the rainforest, and we attended a rare Bwiti initiation of pygmies. You know, like perfect National Geographic material. This is like National Geographic wet dream. And we photographed it with the racist film, and we got back to England and we tried to process it, and unfortunately only one clip, one frame of this entire thing worked. The rest was just blank. And the reason it's so pink is that green pigment deteriorates the quickest. So because the green deteriorates, it's a very magenta picture. So that's the reason. So they were really pissed off with us, again. What was the question?
Doesn't matter now.
Okay.
I think we're over. We're going to open for questions now.
Yeah,
is that
okay
with you?
Sure.
Quem quiser perguntar, estamos aqui.
Anybody got any questions? No, everyone's tired. It's been a long day. What time is it?
Well, I have a question.
You've had lots of questions.
Eu vou perguntar uma pergunta para animar vocês. Ele tem uma série de trabalhos de retratos. O primeiro dele se chama Trust, né? E o, não sei se é o último, mas... o primeiro é Trust, em 2000. Depois ele tem essa série To Photograph a Dark Horse, 2012. E o último é The Spirit is a Bone. Esse The Spirit is a Bone foram retratos criados a partir de uma tecnologia de reconhecimento facial desenvolvida pela polícia de Moscou. Então, eu queria, do primeiro trabalho ao último, o que, que mudou na sua percepção em relação à tecnologia da fotografia? E como é que isso mudou o seu interesse no retrato?
Okay, I think this should definitely be the last because everyone's very tired. But I'll make it really quick. You're speaking about it is our last book, and it's called Spirit is a Bone, and it's a work that has been made using a technology that's extremely new and quite frightening. It's been invented in Moscow, in Russia, by computer programmers who have been struggling with how to make what they call non-collaborative portraiture. Non-collaborative portraiture means a portrait that's taken without the collaboration or even the knowledge of the subject. And when you think about the first picture that we took of the woman under anesthetic, I think that this series really connects thematically with that first project. What's amazing about this technology, the way it works, is it collects parts of your face as you move around the city. So if it was set up in São Paulo, you would get up, have breakfast, go to work. And as you navigate through the city, you would be photographed in different ways by different cameras that would then connect with each other and create a photograph of your face. But it's not really a photograph. It's actually a kind of death mask or life mask that can be rotated in space. And compared to a database of images, and it's a facial recognition system. So this is the most contemporary form of portraiture that you can imagine. And what we did is we looked back at the history of portraiture and August Sander. Everyone knows August Sander, you know, who did the famous Citizens of the 20th Century, where he photographed all different aspects of Weimar German Republic, Weimar society. This is the bricklayer. These are young farmer boys. This is the chef. And we decided to take these titles, throw the pictures away, take the titles, and reenact his life's work in a week, which we did using this camera. So we recast all of those archetypes. We found a baker. We found a bricklayer. We found a revolutionary. We found a writer. We found a painter, a painter's wife. There are 130 of them. And we gathered them one by one, and we made them walk through this machine. And we created a series of portraits. Unlike August Sander's portraits, we only need the two eyes, the nose, and the mouth. The rest is unnecessary. And in fact, the image, the image isn't really necessary. It's just data. And what this points to is the idea of the data shadow, you know, that we all have. We all have a Facebook and an Instagram and your bank accounts and your all sorts of information that's out there, and it exists as a kind of portrait of you. It describes what you bought, for breakfast. It describes, you know, where you travel, which borders you cross. It's a portrait. The idea of portraiture has expanded to, let's go back to your question about this digital database. There's this data shadow that we all carry around us, above us, around us, that is part of this idea of portraiture. So this was, August Sander photographed a revolutionary. We photographed a member of the Pussy Riot group. These are different professions. This was a philosopher. The equipment wasn't really, it was still in a prototype stage, and it didn't work very well. And interestingly, it was unable to photograph children. No idea why, I think. So here we have all the professions of August Sander rendered in this very dead, depressing way. And, you know, August Sander's project was an amazing record of a moment in time. And he had very humanistic kind of ideological kind of ambitions with his project. But then the Second World War happened and the rise of Nazi Germany, and this idea of classifying people suddenly started to feel melancholic, almost sinister, you know? And I think this kind of, we wanted to try and create a work that was, you know, thinking about that, this idea of a humanistic portrait versus a portrait that is made by the state, for the state, against the citizen. Because we live in an age where we no longer have privacy. You know, the very idea of privacy has been renegotiated and redefined. And it's been redefined in the favor of the state and against the citizen. So that's what I think this work is really trying to tackle. But maybe we should end there and go and have a drink.